glad you're here. Let's open up our Bibles. If you don't have one, somebody sitting next to you will share. If not, steal it and repent. Sometimes there are periodically throughout the pews Bibles for you to use. If you need one and you can't find one, raise your hand and somebody here will get a book into your fingers. We've been going through the book of Galatians, and we're going to start today in verse 11. And last time we kind of looked at the fact that there are false gospels. Paul starts off defending his apostleship, the fact that God actually sent him, this God who raised people from the dead, this God who raised Jesus from the dead, and revealed this gospel to him. And this gospel is competing, although it's not really a competition, against false gospels that are kind of pervasive throughout this first century Christianity. We tend to think today that false gospels or false religion is just a problem that we deal with. And we tend to think, oh, back in the first century, it would have been much easier to be a Christian because you didn't have to pick what kind of Christian you were going to be. And unfortunately, that's just not the case. We can see that here in Galatians. Paul is already dealing with people who are teaching different gospels. You can see over in 1 Corinthians the fact that people are already arguing about which teachers they follow. And you have begun to see, or you can see, sects and divisions within the body of Christ. And that will be a huge argument that Paul takes up and other writers take up, and Jesus even takes up through his lifetime. So there's always been this tendency amongst humanity to divide, amongst humanity to change what God says and to create different gospels. And so there really was, so to speak, no golden age of Christianity in which there was just one choice. Maybe you could make the argument that on the day of Pentecost, when Peter preached for the very first time, and the gospel of Jesus is heard proclaimed among men in its fullness for the very first time, maybe then you could argue that there was just one choice. But by Tuesday of the next week, there was probably at least three. And so people just tend to splinter and fragment, and it is our job as people who are trying to be faithful to God to go back and find this gospel that was revealed to Paul, this gospel that Peter and Paul and John and James and all of the other apostles and Christians in the first century, these faithful Christians that we can read about, preached and taught and showed and shared to other people. So as we pick up, let's just read. We're going to read in Galatians chapter 1, and we're going to read verse 11 down through verse 17. Although we're really going to focus on verses 11 through 14. We're just going to kind of read this chunk. I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people, so extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my fathers. But when he who had set me apart before I was born, and who called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me, in order that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately consult with anyone, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me, but I went away into Arabia and returned again to Damascus. And he will continue on talking about some various things. I think it's important that we understand, as we're getting into this, that Paul isn't saying these things so we can write a biography about him. Right? He's not saying these things so that in a Bible class we can figure out the timeline of Paul's life. Now, what he's saying is true. But the point that he's making isn't to give us a sketch, an autobiography, so to speak, of the Apostle Paul in the first century. I don't know what he would call it. Maybe Paul, a pioneer for the faith, something like that. That's not his intent. This isn't about Paul. Paul is making the argument that the gospel that he preached didn't come from him. That's the argument that Paul is making. And so if anything, Paul is separating himself from other people, saying that I didn't have to go get approval for the things that I preached because God showed them to me. God taught me. And so kind of keep that in mind as we're reading through this, that we need to understand these things in the argument that Paul is making. So again, running up to it, in the first 10 verses of this letter so far, Paul has defended both the message and the messenger. Right? He's defended his apostleship, and he has defended the message as coming from God. That there is a single message that comes from God. And this is important so we can have faith in the message, so that we can know that the gospel that we hear, the gospel that we see Paul preaching, is the real gospel. That we can find these marks as you're reading through when Paul talks about the gospel of Jesus. We can find these marks of the true gospel of Christ, and we can look at what we believe and see if we match. And if we don't match, we should change. But we can test our faith to see whether or not we are in the Lord. We can also have faith in the messenger. Now, I don't mean faith for salvation, and I don't mean faith in the same way that we have faith in God, but that we can trust Paul as a messenger sent by the God who we do trust. And that God would send, that God would choose a faithful apostle, a faithful messenger to deliver this message, and that God would record this message for us from this messenger. This is important so that we can have faith in the one who sent the messenger. And that we can have faith in God, that we can see that God keeps his promises. And all of these things are important. And so as Paul is moving through and making his argument, when you get to verse 11, he says, I would have you know, brothers, the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel. So what's the first thing he says? The first thing he says, his first argument, is that the gospel of God has a heavenly author. Right? That's his argument. And you can see the same argument being made over in places like Hebrews chapter 12, where God is called the author and perfecter of our faith, or God is the author and finisher of our faith. There are various ways of describing that. He is basically the source. He is the start and the finish of our faith. God is. So this gospel has a heavenly author. And God has been authoring or showing or revealing or making known this gospel since the very beginning of time. And this gospel has been revealed in the law and the prophets. You can see again over in Romans chapter 1, we referenced that last week, that in Romans chapter 1, Paul says that the apostles and the prophets and the law, God has revealed these things through those. They testify to it. Jesus himself would say to the scribes and the Pharisees and the Sadducees and other religious leaders, as you search the scriptures because in them you think you have eternal life, but it is those things, those scriptures, that testify about me. So God has been telling us about Jesus from the very beginning. He has been showing us Jesus. He's been telling us what is coming, and now he has come in the first century. And now that he has come, we can see not only what he did, but we can see what he is still doing today, and we can see what he's going to do later because these things have been made known to us by a heavenly author. The next thing we can see, as you're going through in verse 12, I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. God's children have a heavenly teacher. And now Paul is making this argument in a very particular way. He's saying something very particular here. It is Paul saying that no Christian, no person who was alive, ever taught him anything. He could be. I don't think he is, but he could be. Or is what Paul is saying here, that when it came to the gospel, that he just suddenly had... He was on his road to Damascus to kill Christians. He gets to Damascus. He's converted. Then all of a sudden, he starts preaching about Jesus instead of killing Jesus' followers. What he's saying here is that God is the one who showed it to him. What he's saying is that he didn't go to school for 15 years before he could be qualified as an apostle. He didn't have to go through some kind of training regimen before God showed him that Jesus is the Messiah. And so what he says here, I wasn't taught it. He's probably comparing this to his time as a Jewish teacher. Right? He sat at the feet of Gamaliel. He studied for years in order to become somebody who is of weight in the Jewish community. And Paul's argument here is that I didn't go to school to become somebody who knew something about God, who knew something about Jesus. Now, he brought all of his previous study with him, which was very helpful. But his argument is that it was God who showed me Jesus. It was God who showed me that Jesus makes all of these things fit together. That Jesus is the point and the purpose of the law and the prophets. That everything was moving toward Jesus. And he will make that very argument later in this letter, that the law was our tutor so that we could be brought to Christ and be saved through Jesus. And so his argument here is not that nobody ever taught him anything, but that the aha moment, where he realizes that everything is about Christ, about Jesus, or that Jesus is the Christ, that was shown to him by God. And we can look over in other places, like in Acts chapter 9, where Jesus will say, I think it's in verse 15, where Jesus will say, I will show him. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. That word show means to teach. When I hear the word revelation, I'm reading through here, I say I received it through a revelation of Jesus, I automatically think in my brain of miraculous impartation of knowledge. The cool thing here is when you look in Acts and you look in Galatians, it's almost like Paul is saying that Jesus was my teacher. He appeared to me on the road, and that's kind of the aha moment. But it's almost like he's saying, when Jesus is saying, I will show, and that word show means I will teach, I will demonstrate, I'm going to sit and talk with him, is kind of what it means. And you see Jesus appearing to Paul at other places in the book of Acts. It seems like Paul is saying, my Christian Gamaliel is the Christ. He is the one who instructed me. He is the one who taught me. And whether you think this means some miraculous impartation of knowledge, or if you think it means that Jesus actually taught Paul, like he did the other disciples, either one is really cool, and it doesn't change the argument that Paul is making, that no person sat and instructed him about these things, but God did. God did. That's Paul's argument. And there is a sense in which we too can be taught by God. Right? Not in the same way as Paul is arguing here. So to say that God teaches us today, it doesn't mean that when I get home, Jesus will be at my kitchen table waiting to have coffee and pie with me. Although if he chose to do so, I wouldn't make him leave. It doesn't mean that he will be there and that he will sit and have a conversation with me. It doesn't mean that as I'm driving home later this afternoon, that something miraculous will enter my brain and zap, God will teach me the deep and secret things of the universe. Although, again, I wouldn't stop him if he wanted to. What this does mean, when we talk about being taught by God, and you can see, like we studied in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 9, where Paul says, you were taught by God how to love. When we read through God's word, and God has revealed these things, has shown these things to us in the scripture, isn't that God teaching us? I argue that it is. God wrote the textbook, so to speak. God is the one who sent the teachers. God is the one who has done everything to make our faith possible. And so in a loose sense, not in the direct and actual sense that Paul means here, whether through revelation or through conversation, that God taught Paul, we can be instructed by God too. And as we see Paul making the claim and making the argument that his instruction, that his understanding of what the gospel is, comes from God, our understanding of what the gospel is must also come from God. Even if it comes in a slightly different way, it has to come from God still. And if we believe something that God hasn't taught, then we're believing in error. And we need to change it. It's really that simple. If we find something that we believe that we shouldn't, then we just change it. And now we're right with God. The next thing he says in verse 13, as you're going through here, for you have heard of my former life in Judaism. And he's basically talking about the way he used to live. Right, there's a really cool picture in here about, and we'll see this again later in the letter, about how he is crucified with Christ, and it is no longer him who lives, but Christ lives in him. And the life that Paul now lives in the flesh, he lives by faith in the Son of God, who loved him and gave himself up for Paul. For me, for you. So there is this really neat picture where Paul is talking about, kind of metaphorically, a previous life. He died, and that person is dead, and now he has a new life. It also means, actually, the way that he used to live. He used to think differently. He used to talk differently. He used to act differently. And when he met Jesus, that changed. It changed dramatically. It changed entirely. The one thing in Paul's life that didn't really change is that before Paul met Jesus, Paul wanted to serve God. And after Paul met Jesus, Paul wanted to serve God. Now his life is completely different because he wants to serve God. And I think in Paul, we can see what ought to happen when we come to know the Lord. There should be a change. And I've heard people argue when we say, well, there should be a dramatic change in your life. If you are converted to the Christ, if you understand what it means to be converted to the Christ, there should be a dramatic change in what you do and where you go and how you think and who you are. And people will say, well, I come from a very religious family. And so there wasn't much to change. Because Paul came from a bunch of heathens who didn't care anything about God. And Paul knew nothing about God before he became a Christian. No, he is the perfect example of how an incredibly religious person should change everything about their life once they've become a Christian. Whether you have no knowledge of God or you think you know about God before you become a Christian and before you really understand, the change should be equally explicit in either life. Because if you believe what the Bible says, whether you didn't know God or whether you did, everybody is shut up under sin when they choose to disobey. And everybody, like Paul will write in Ephesians chapter 2, is dead in their trespasses. It's not like religious people are a little less dead in their trespasses, and so they have slightly less resurrection needed. No, equally dead, equally far away, equally without hope. And so the change in somebody's life should be equally explicit, though the things in particular that may change should be different or might be different. But there should be a dramatic change. And here is your perfect example of the change in life of a religious person that we should see in people who are converted. I think I was a pretty religious person before I became a Christian. I even brought my Bible to Bible studies. Whether we opened it or used it is a completely different discussion, but I actually brought it. I had my name engraved on the front and everything in silver letters, not gold, because we don't want to be too flashy, right? I mean, I was a pretty religious person, but when I came to know the Lord, or like Paul will say, rather to be known by him, it changed. Everything changes. Everything changes. There's a pivot. And yeah, you know, I didn't beat people up and rob banks before, so I'm certainly not going to start doing that. But there should be explicit and real changes in my life that when people who know you come to see you after you've become a Christian, they just say, there's something different about you. What happened? That is the kind of change that should happen. It is, at the very least, the kind of change that we should be working to get in our life. The dangerous thing today, and in Paul's day, is that religion becomes kind of cultural. And whether you get it or you don't, not much really changes. That's dangerous. That's a snare and a trap of Satan, and we will definitely talk some more about that later. But brothers and sisters and friends and visitors, we have to change. We have to be different when we come to the Lord, like Paul is different. So as we continue looking in this, Paul is going to say, you heard about my former life in Judaism. And then he's going to talk about some things that Satan did through him. And when you think about people in the Bible that Satan worked through, probably don't think of Paul. But look at what he says. How I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond my own age among my people, so extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my fathers. And that's where we're going to stop. Because in that section of the text, I think we can see a few ways that Satan works against God's people. In 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8, we're told that Satan is a prowling lion. He is out. He is roaring, the text says. And he is seeking people to devour. And he is not a friendly little kitty that you keep at home and he's nice to play with. He is an angry, mean, roaring lion seeking people to devour. In John chapter 8 and verse 44, we talked a little bit about this morning from Isaiah. When Jesus talks about Satan, let's look over and let's see what Jesus says about Satan. This is our adversary. This is who we are up against. And he plays by a set of rules They're just not God's rules. Look, starting in verse 42. Jesus says to them, "If God were your Father, you would love me. For I came from God, and I am here. I came not of my own accord, but he sent me. Why do you not understand what I say?" Have you ever asked that question? You're trying to explain something to somebody. You're just like, "Why don't you know the words that are coming out of my mouth?" I think every parent of a three-year-old has said that at one point or another. Every teacher, every relative of a three-year-old has said that at one point or another. It is because you cannot bear to hear my words. One of the kids, I don't remember which one said it, but when they would get in trouble and we would come and we would talk to them about what they did, they would say, "I can't hear your words." Could they? Yeah, they could hear the words, but they didn't want to hear the words. And that's what Jesus is saying here. This is why you can't understand what I'm saying. It's because you don't want to understand what I'm saying. It's because you cannot bear to hear my word. You are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. Jesus is so gentle. He was a murderer from the beginning, and he does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I tell you the truth, you do not believe me. Which one of you convicts me of sin? If I tell you the truth, why do you not believe me? Whoever is of God hears the words of God. The reason why you do not hear them is that you are not of God. Very straightforward. There are people who don't want to hear. There are people who don't hear because their father is the devil. Their father is worldliness. Their father is sin and crime and death and all of those things that get lumped in with Satan. And Jesus, describing Satan, says he is a murderer and a liar from the beginning, and that there is no truth in him. That's who we're fighting. And in Galatians chapter 1, I think we can see some of the ways that Satan fights. He is the black-headed cowboy in the movies. And this is nothing about people today who actually wear black hats. If you have a black cowboy hat, that's wonderful. But in the movies, the bad guy typically wears a black hat. That's how you know he's Black Bart. And the way you see the bad cowboy throw dirt in the white hat cowboy's face, right? The way you see the bad guys, you know, trick the Lone Ranger and steal his horse, or whatever they do, the way they always fight dirty, that's what Satan does. He fights dirty. And so what we can see here in this passage is that Satan will use anything he can to trip you up, to destroy you. Because when you become a Christian, not only will there be a dramatic change in your life, but you have enlisted in the Lord's army, you're in the Lord's kingdom, you're in the Lord's army, and Satan is now going to try and attack to kill you. Satan uses violence. Look at what Paul says. "I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it." Paul was played by Satan against the early Christians. I mean, there's not a better way to say that, I don't think. There's not a polite way to say that Paul was deceived. And he went about doing the work of Satan. In Acts chapter 7 and verse 58, the men who are about to stone Stephen come and they lay their coats at the feet of Stephen. Some people think that this means that are at the feet of Saul. Some people think that this means Saul sat as judge, kind of over the mock trial or the punishment phase of Stephen's trial. And in Acts chapter 8 and verse 1, Saul not only judged Stephen as worthy of death, but he approved it. He approved it. He liked it. He desired it, that word means. So his desire wasn't that these Christians would come to know God better and be right. His desire was to kill them. He wasn't interested in teaching them better. He was interested in killing them. That's what it means, that approval that Saul gave, is he wanted to destroy these Christians. So vehement and violent was his hatred for them and what they believed. Saul made, in Acts chapter 9 and verse 1, it said that he went about breathing threats and murder against the church. It means that Saul made his life about killing Christians. We talked this morning in Bible class. Brother Wendt made the idea that he thinks of God as being the air that he breathes. What he means is, he's our life. He is our life. And so when Saul goes about breathing threats and murder against the church, Saul has made it his life to kill Christians. The way we might say that in Texas is he eats that for breakfast. It's what he did. Paul suffered violence himself when he became a Christian. Paul was useful to Satan as long as he wasn't a Christian. The moment he becomes one, now he's an enemy. And immediately, this man who was killing Christians comes under threat of violence himself, to the point where he has to be snuck out of cities. He will be beaten several times. He will be stoned. He will be thrown into pits to fight with animals. In 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 12, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. That doesn't mean that everybody's going to have to fight wild beasts, or that everybody will be beaten with rods, or any particular type of persecution. But if you are trying to live a godly life in Christ Jesus, and that's the key, not that at some point you became a Christian, but if you are trying to live a godly life in Christ Jesus, you will suffer persecution. The gospel is increasingly unpopular and is being reacted to now as hate speech. As our nation's reaction to hate speech becomes increasingly vitriolic, increasingly exaggerated, I don't think it'll be long before people who talk about God begin, unless things change, and hopefully they do, begin to be in public danger for talking about Jesus. Satan uses, if you continue looking at what he says, Satan uses prestige and position. In verse 14, I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people. That word advancing is pretty interesting. It literally means moving to the final stage. He was it. Paul was it when it came to Judaism. He was moving on up to the east side, right? He had it going in the right direction. There was nobody who was going to stop Paul from becoming the next rabbi. Not just a rabbi, but the rabbi. When people had a question, they would go and they would ask Paul. He would have been the rabbi today that people mentioned to settle their debates. You'll hear people mention Hillel and Shammai. Today it would be Hillel and Shammai and Shaul. He changed. He leaves Hebraism and will become a Christian. This position and prestige would be a very strong lure. And I would argue that it's probably his high rank in Judaism, especially his high rank at a young age. His high rank is probably one of the things that made it difficult for him to hear the gospel of Jesus. The more entrenched people get in any kind of organization, whether it's a false religion or a business, the more entrenched people get in that idea, the more difficult it is to draw them out. When a Mormon apostle, you don't need to know anything about the structure of the Latter-day Saints religion. Just know that one of the apostles is like one of the 12 highest people. When a Mormon apostle leaves the faith, it makes headlines. Worldwide headlines. Because people who get to that level in the LDS church don't typically leave. If a cardinal in the Catholic Church were to leave tomorrow, he just wakes up. It's a Monday. It's a good day to not be Catholic anymore. There would be headlines. You would hear about it on CNN. You would hear about it on Fox. It would be mentioned because cardinals don't just leave the Catholic Church. You're pretty entrenched by the time you get to wear the red robe and skullcap. Right? It's just kind of how it works. And so as Paul is moving up and up in the ranks of Jerusalem, of Judaism, Paul leaving Judaism would be like tomorrow, Mike Pence deciding he didn't want to be a politician anymore. What are the chances of that happening? By the time you become vice president, I would argue you're fairly entrenched in the system. You're not going to go anywhere. You're going to wake up tomorrow and you're going to still want to be vice president. Unless you can become president. Right? So that was Paul. That's exactly who Paul is. Why would he leave? It would be silly for him to do so. And if we think that Satan doesn't do that to us, oh, we are so silly. If we think that Satan won't use power over people, maybe in a local government, if we think that Satan won't use power as being the employer over us, if we think that Satan won't use money and the lure of wealth and the lure of opportunity to improve our lives and make it better, if we think that Satan won't use that stuff against us, we're wrong. Now, is it wrong to go to school and get a degree and try to make something in the world, to make a positive impact on society and try to help people and to try and do a good job? No. I would argue that the Bible says those are all things that we should be doing, that we should be trying to work hard, to become good at whatever it is we do. Greg right now wants to be a garbage man, amongst other things. A garbage man or a farmer. That's what he wants to do. We drive down the road, and every time he sees a tractor, he flips out. Tractor! He's learning the names of the different pieces of machinery, and every time we see them, he yells it out. Front end loader! Digger! Bulldozer! And he gets really excited over bulldozers. Really excited. It would tickle him to death if he got to grow up and be a farmer. Right now. I don't know if he'll keep that. Maybe he will. My wish for Greg is not that he would do something more dignified. My wish for Greg is that he would become the greatest farmer he possibly could. And that he would farm like nobody else's business. And that people would one day come to him for farming advice. And that he would learn to tone it down a little when he talks about the equipment. But that he would share that advice happily and willingly. And that if somebody was hungry and in need of food, he wouldn't, you know, dismiss them because he needs his bottom line to be a little bit higher. My hope is that he would give them food, that he would share things with people, that whatever the Lord blesses him with, he would use all of his blessings to help people, whether as a farmer, as a trash man, or anything else. That's what I would want him to do. And that's what God expects from us. But if we think that Satan won't use things like work to get us to abandon our families, or to work too much, or to work for the wrong things, or to get us focused on physical things rather than spiritual things, then we're mistaken. Because it happened to Paul. And if Paul could make this mistake, then it's a walk in the park for Satan to trick me. The next thing that I think we see Paul doing is that he kind of gets caught up in human traditions. Right? He's advancing in Judaism because he is so extremely zealous for the traditions of his fathers. He couldn't get past the way that we always do things. That's what a tradition is. A tradition in and of itself isn't bad. It's just something that's handed down. Paul later would talk about the traditions that he hands down as an apostle. So traditions in and of themselves aren't bad. They're bad when we assume that what we've always done is the only way to do things, or if we assume that the way we've always done it is always right. Because that's not the case. Not always the case. Sometimes the way we've done it before is good and right, and it doesn't need to be changed or altered in any way. Sometimes there's a better way to do things, and sometimes our traditions actually violate what God says. Jesus would talk to some people in the first century, and he would tell them that they break the commandments. They violate God's word in order to keep their traditions. And Paul was in that lot. Right? He was going against God's plan for mankind by fighting against the church. And he was fighting against the church because he thought that's what God wanted. That's what his traditions told him he should be doing. And what we see is in Acts chapter 17 and verse 11, we see people like these Bereans in Acts chapter 17 and verse 11. They're called noble-minded, not because they read the Bible. At that time, it would be the Old Testament. Not because they read the Old Testament. Do we think that Paul never read the Old Testament? Do we think that the Pharisees never read the Old Testament? No, they did. What made the Bereans noble-minded was that they read the scriptures not to prove themselves right, but to find what was right. There's a huge difference there. If we have a particular practice, let's just say it's eating mashed potatoes on Tuesday, and we open up the Bible, and we seek to prove that you must eat mashed potatoes on Tuesday, which in and of itself is not a bad idea, but that you must eat mashed potatoes on Tuesday, then guess what I guarantee you you're going to find somewhere in the Bible. You will find something that tells you you have to eat mashed potatoes on Tuesday. But if you approach the Bible with an open mind, which is incredibly easy to say and very hard to do, if we approach the Bible with an open mind and say, let's find out what God thinks about this, and let's see if there's any place where God actually instructs this, and maybe we need to kind of step back from saying you have to do it, or maybe we even need to stop it altogether. But let's just open up and see what it is that God says. That's what made the people in Berea noble-minded. Not that they read the scriptures, but that they searched the scriptures trying to find what was right, not seeking to prove themselves right. There's a big difference. And Paul, unfortunately, found himself doing that very thing. If we think that Paul didn't have scripture for what he was doing, we're wrong. He had biblical references, I'm sure, when he went and argued before the high priest that it was necessary to kill the Christians. I'm sure that in the letters that he brought, charging him with overseeing the capture and death of punishment of these Christians, that there were scriptural references in the letter. I'm sure there were. But there were an attempt to prove himself right rather than finding what it was that God wanted. And he did this because of his zeal. And that's the next thing it says. He was zealous for the traditions of his fathers. There's a passage over in James that says, the wrath of man does not bring about the righteousness of God. And oh, brother, can we be wrathful? Can we? But our wrath, our anger, our zeal, whether it's positive or negative, does not make us frightened. This man, Paul, over in Acts chapter 22, when he's giving an account of himself, in Acts chapter 22, look at verses 3 and 5. He is giving a defense of his life and his ministry before these people who are questioning him. He says, I am a Jew, born in Tarsus in Cilicia, but brought up in this city, and educated at the feet of Gamaliel. Do you see why it's so important that he says, I wasn't taught this by anybody, over in Galatians chapter 1. According to the strict manner of the law of our fathers, being zealous for God, as all of you are this day, I persecuted this way to the death, binding and delivering to prison both men and women, as the high priest and the whole council of elders can bear me witness. From them I received letters to the brothers, and I journeyed toward Damascus to take those who were there and bring them in bonds to Jerusalem to be punished. Why? Because he was zealous for the traditions of his fathers, and with a clear conscience before God, he put men and women to death. He would say later in the book of Acts that he has tried to live his whole life with a clear conscience before men and before God. Well, how can he say that if he's out murdering people? He can say that because he thought it's what God wanted him to do. And he thought that God had directed him to kill the Christians. Because in his mind, these followers of the way, these disciples of Jesus, they are blasphemers. Because they are claiming that this carpenter from Nazareth is the divine Son of God, which is blasphemy in his mind. And the punishment for blasphemy is death. And so he is going and collecting them, and he is killing them justly and rightly and according to the scriptures. Paul with a clear conscience. A clear, honestly mistaken conscience. Disobeyed God and put his people to death. Our zeal and our enthusiasm and our sincerity do not make us right before God. That is so important. Our zeal and our enthusiasm and our sincerity do not make us right before God. Not everyone. And this is where we kind of have to check our pessimism, right? We can be optimistic about the world that we live in. Not everyone who hasn't followed Jesus is wicked. Not everybody who hasn't followed Jesus is just an enemy and wants to completely destroy and utterly mutilate Christianity. Oh, some are. But there are people like Paul who are unknowingly enemies. He is not out to destroy God. He is out to serve God. He is honestly and zealously mistaken. And if Paul can be honestly and zealously mistaken, I count him as a much more spiritual and much more intelligent person than myself. And if Paul can be honestly and zealously mistaken, then surely we too can be duped into fighting for Satan like Paul did. I'm standing for the truth is something I have heard people say who were doing no such thing. And the fact that I firmly and honestly believe something doesn't mean it is God's truth. Often when people say that, not always, there are times when I have heard people say that, and I think they actually were standing for what God said. But the danger comes when we couple this zeal with our pride. But the idea that there's no way I could be wrong. There's no way I could misunderstand this. It's how we've always done it. It must be right. And then we stand for that. We have to be careful that we're zealous for what God says and not for what we believe God says. And there is a difference in those two things. That's where we'll finish in the letter of Galatians today. And I think it is Paul's attempt here to demonstrate the fact that Satan is conniving, and he is a terrible, horrible enemy. And at one point, Paul found himself under the influence of that adversary, fighting against the gospel. And the change in his life, and the change in his teaching, and what he said, and where he went, what he did, was evidence of the fact that he was no longer working for the enemy. Because ultimately, whether we're honestly mistaken or not, ultimately, there are only two answers on the day of judgment. You will either be a sheep or a goat. You will either be saved or you will not. You will either enter into the joy of the Master or you will be cast into the darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. And we have to make sure, we have to know that on that day, we will be welcomed in. We haven't talked about it, but there is a way that you can know where you will be. It includes living a faithful life from the point you choose to follow Jesus forward, but it begins by choosing Christ. In Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, around 2,000 years ago, Peter stood up and he answered the question, somebody said, what must we do to be saved? And Peter stood up and he said, repent. And every one of you believe, or every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And this promise is for you and for your children and all who are far off, everyone the Lord our God will call to himself. That answer is still the same. What must you do to be saved? You must believe Jesus of Nazareth is the Messiah, the Son of God, crucified and resurrected, sitting at the right hand of the Father in heaven. And you must be baptized into his name for the forgiveness of your sins. And then live faithfully. If there's anything that we can do to help you today, please, please come while we stand and sing our song.